I'll say a little bit more about Howard later, but Howard is involved, as you may know, with a charity called Shared Hope. And this is a charity which is a Christian charity working in numerous countries, mainly in Africa, but also in places like Pakistan and Thailand and Madagascar. And we're hoping that he's going to tell us something about that during the programme this morning. And when I heard that he was going to be speaking about Shared Hope, I just couldn't resist the idea of thinking of hope as a bit of a theme. What is it that you're hoping for? I wonder if any of the children would like to answer that question for me right now. I know it's not really the children's slot just yet. Grace is going to be doing that for us shortly. Anyone? I'm just looking in the screen to see if anyone's ready to unmute. Nobody? Nobody hopes for anything anymore?
For COVID to stop.
Oh, for COVID to stop. That's a good one. Yes. Yes. Very good. Well, we hope for all sorts of different things, don't we? I mean, I'm hoping, for example, that the weather might be quite good tomorrow, because I'd quite like to get on the golf course. Some people might be hoping that Rangers will win the league. I know the children will be hoping that they get back to school soon, or maybe that we get a proper dump of snow this winter so they can get some proper sledging done. Or maybe some people are hoping for a job or to get accepted onto a course or for a pay rise or to lose weight. Or as we've heard, that the pandemic will soon be over and we can start getting together with our friends and so on again. Hope is that quality that we want an outcome that makes our life better in some way. Not only it can make a tough situation more bearable, but it can improve our lives because we think of a better future. It motivates us and we have hope. And it's a tremendously invigorating quality. Hope. And there are lots of reasons for hope around the world, and I'm sure Howard will be speaking to us about some of these, whether it's healthcare or clean water or immunisation or peace or whatever. But you know, it made me think a little bit. There was an old question that used to be posed in what was known as the Heidelberg Catechism. I don't expect you to know about this, but it has a very interesting question to start with. And the question is, in a sense, about hope. This was a catechism which was used to teach the message of the Christian faith to people, and it was published back in the year 1563. And the very first question is this: what is your only comfort in life and death? Now, I wonder how you would answer that question. Well, the answer given in the Heidelberg Catechism is this: my only comfort in life and death is that I am not my own, but belong, body and soul, in life and death, to my faithful Saviour, Jesus Christ. He has fully paid for all my sins with his blood and has set me free from the tyranny of the devil, and he watches over me in such a way that not a hair can fall from my head without the will of my Father in heaven. In fact, all things must work together for my salvation. What is our hope in life and death? And our hope is in Christ. Let's just pause and have a prayer as we gather together to worship this morning, and then we'll listen to this praise song and you can enjoy that as we share it together. Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning. We thank you for all the many gifts that you give us. We thank you that our lives can be infused not with despair, but with genuine hope. Hope, which is what your word describes as the substance of things not yet seen. And yet we find these many promises in your word about what the future would hold for those who are part of your family. And we thank you this morning, Heavenly Father, that by trusting in the Lord Jesus, we can, with all the authority of your word, count ourselves as children of God, as part of your family. And so as we come this morning to worship and to praise, even though we are separated like this, we do thank you that we can be, in a sense, together online. And we pray that we'll have a time which is not only constructive in our lives, but a time which is a real blessing to us. And that the flavour of this hour that we spend together will go with us into the week. That our week will be infused with hope, hope for a better outcome, but hope above everything else in what the Lord Jesus has done for us. And so we just bring these, our prayers and our thanks to you this morning, in the name of the Lord Jesus himself. Amen.
soul. God is good, God is good. Where is His grace and goodness known? In our great Redeemer's blood, who holds our faith when fears arise, who stands above the stormy trial, who sends the waves that bring us nigh unto the shore.
Now, at this point, I'd like to hand over to Grace Price, who's been giving some thought to the slot for the children. So, Grace, over to you. Thank you very much.
Myself. Hello. Good morning. Can I see all the lovely Lennox Church kids? If you can come up close, give me a wave so I know you can see me and hear me okay. Give me a wave. I can see a few people waving, so I'm hoping that means a lot of you can see me. Excellent. Well, before I start, I want to introduce to you one of my friends. It's a good friend of mine, Benji the Bunny. Now, Benji, can you come and say hello? Actually, I'm a bit worried. Benji's not really wanting to say hello this morning. That's really unusual for Benji. Benji, would you like to just sit out to the side for a bit? Maybe just listen and come back later. He's a bit miserable. Oh, dear. I don't know. It's not normal for Benji to be like that. But hey, look, don't worry. He'll come back later. Let's think about what we're going to learn about this morning. We're going to learn about how do we use our shield, okay? How do we use our shield? Oh, did you know we have a shield? Well, guess what? I've been reading my Bible, and I know that God is my shield. And the Bible teaches us the truth that through Jesus, God is a shield. And also that God gives us a shield. Well, I've made a homemade shield. It doesn't look like very much. I don't know if you can see it on my screen. It's kind of small, but we'll have a look at a bit later what this shield is really like. But why do we use a shield and why do we need a shield? Can I ask someone, anyone got any ideas of why do we use a shield and why do we need a shield? Unmute if you like. Is that your finger up, Ruby? Go on.
So we're protected.
Okay, we need a shield to be protected. Any other ideas?
Go on.
Give us a wave or just unmute yourself. Oh, is that you, Anna? Go, Anna.
To shield us against sin.
Okay, yes, the shield is against sin. When it comes from God's shield, it's when we use God's shield, it's to use it to shield us against sin, to protect us. Any other thoughts? I can only see really one screen here at the moment, so I'm sorry if anyone I can't see, just unmute yourself and call out. Oh, hold on, did I see you? Is that you, Milo? Go, Milo.
What?
It is used to represent who we are, like.
Oh, I like that.
Or anything on a shield, like it could be a symbol or something on a shield represents who we are.
Excellent. I love that. Yeah, it definitely has been used as a shield, can be used as a way to represent who we are and what we stand for, what we what message we're trying to give, especially when you go into battle. You see people paint their shields with all sorts of symbols that tell us of who we are. But we definitely need a shield when we are in a battle, when we're under attack, when we need to have something that will protect us from, like, maybe arrows or snowballs, depending what type of shield you're, what game you're playing. But you need these shields to protect yourself, but you can use it to protect others as well. So, for example, if you are under attack and your parent was there or someone who wanted to care for you was there, they'd say, get behind me. I'm going to protect you with my shield. And so, yes, you can use it to shield yourself, but you can use it to shield others and protect yourselves from anything that's been thrown at you, so that would try and stop you from going forward or stop you from being who you need to be in that moment. Well, let me see. So a shield is very, very useful, but I want us to think about what God says in his Bible, what he tells us about the shield. And from his Bible, he tells a shield can be, well, yes, God is a shield. We know that from the Bible, but we also know that we've got different ways to explain what a shield is. A shield is a shield of love, a shield of truth, a shield of faith. And there's even like a description that says that it's a shield of your salvation. So saying that it's a shield of God's salvation, his rescue over us. But you know, God has given us a shield, and a shield to use when we're under attack, when we've got someone trying to bring us down. Now I want you to look more let's just try and see if you can see this a bit better. But on my shield, I've stuck some words from the Bible on my shield that tell me about the truth of who Jesus Christ is, and also some words that Jesus has said, because, you know, when Jesus speaks, he tells the truth. He tells us what is really the truth. So I want to just have a little closer look. On one of my verses, it says that Jesus said, I have loved you even as the Father has loved me. Now, I got these verses from the Bible, so I know it's telling me the truth what Jesus is saying. He says, I have loved you. So I know that to be the truth. Okay, so Jesus loves us, and he loves me, and he loves you. But actually, I've missed something right in the middle of my shield. I've got a verse that says, Jesus said he came to give us his life as a ransom. So he came and he paid the price for our sins, for those things that we've done wrong that separate us from God. And he said, look, Jesus has said, I'm the one that's paid the price. I've done it for you. The price is paid. Now, another verse on here is it says, God is with us. It comes from Matthew. And he tells us that Jesus, his name is Emmanuel, and that means God is with us. So that means we're not alone. God is with us. So we know that to be the absolute truth, that God is with us, because that's the name of Jesus. God is with us, Emmanuel. Another thing we know that's the truth, and Jesus said this, he said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. So we know who we are in Jesus. We know which way to go, and we know that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. So we don't need to be tricked by any other lies or anything other than knowing that Jesus is the one we follow. What other one is there here? Well, I can see it says that For God so loved the world so much that he gave his one and only Son, so that everyone who believes in him will not perish but have eternal life. That's really important. That is actually really amazing what's just been said there. That he's saying, Jesus said this. Now, so we know this is what is an absolute truth, that Jesus has said that everyone who believes in him will not perish. So we won't be brought down. We won't be brought down to, so we don't know what's going to happen to us. We're not going to be separated from God. We're not going to be destroyed, because we know that if we believe in him and trust him, we will not perish. And one other truth I like, I can see on my shield, it says, he has risen from the dead. That's Jesus has risen from the dead. And he also said, that I have overcome the world, so that we know that Jesus has the power to overcome death, and that he has overcome the world, and that power comes from God. So Jesus has the power and he has the strength to do everything, to overcome everything. Wow. So we've got those truths that we can stand by and know to be truth. So we can't be tricked, okay? Because when we use our shield, and we use our shield that tells us the truth of who God is, who Jesus is, then we will not be brought down by any arrows or anything that could bring us down. But hold on. Come on. Oh, Benji wants to come back again. Hi, Benji. Come back. Oh, my goodness. Benji, how are you doing? He still looks quite miserable, actually. That's not good at all, Benji. Do you want to tell us more about what's been happening? Oh, he's not going to tell us, but he wants to show us. He wants to show us what's been happening to him this week. Maybe we can understand better why he's looking so down and so miserable. Now, Benji, you want me to share the screen? Okay, I'm going to try and share the screen with you of what's been happening with Benji. One moment. Let's see if we can get this. Whoops. Let's see. Oh, it doesn't want to. Hold on. Share, it says. Oh, very good. Excellent. Benji, we're going to share what your week's been like. Let's see. Can you? Well, hopefully you can hear what's being said as well. All right. Ooh, that's a fiery arrow. Ouch. You are so weak. My goodness. Nobody loves you. Oh, you're on your own. My goodness, you're under attack. Fiery arrows everywhere. You always do things that are wrong. You don't know which way to go. Oh my, Benji, you've had an awful week. No wonder you're down and you're miserable. Oops, where we go? Let me bring back our screen there. So Benji's been really miserable this week, and I can see why. You're down. Can anyone here help me out? Can we help Benji? What can we do to help Benji? Let's watch that video again, and this time I'll pause it, and maybe we can think about how we can use what's on the shield to help Benji extinguish those lies, because I think the devil's been trying to bring Benji down, and we know how to stop that. It's because we've got a shield, the shield that we can use. Now, one of those things, let's go back to it again, to the very beginning. Let's see, Benji, we're going to help you out here. It's a bit tricky with this screen. Here we go. Let's watch this. Oh, there's an attack. What does this say? You are so weak. Hold on. Can anyone help me? What could we use from off this shield to help Benji know that you are not so weak? Has anyone? What could we use? Could we use, you could use all of it, but what some specific things you could use? Could we use, I am the way, the truth, and the life, or Jesus is risen, he risen from the dead? Just unmute yourself if you want to give an answer, because I can't really see everyone. I can only see a couple of people, I'm afraid. How could we do that? Well, you know what I think we could do? We could use, did someone unmute themselves? I thought I could hear them. Not to worry. Okay, so maybe we could use, I reckon we could use this truth from the Bible, what Jesus says. He says, I have overcome the world, and also that he has risen from the dead. So you know what, Benji, you do not need to use your strength. You need to rely on God's strength, on this power of God. That same power that rose Jesus from the dead, you now can use, Benji, okay? So how about use that when you're under attack? Think about how Jesus has overcome, and you can rely on his power to do that. But sometimes you even feel too weak to hold up the shield. You feel that you just don't even have the strength to stand behind the shield. But you don't have to worry, because it's God's power that's doing that, not your power, Benji. Okay, let's have a look. What's the other thing that was going on with you? What? Nobody loves you. What verse could we use? What thing could we say to Benji? What could we say to Benji that's on our shield to say, that's not true? That's a lie from the devil. That's not real at all. Any thoughts? Just unmute yourself and yell out if you want, if you can. Go for it.
For God to love the world.
Yeah, absolutely. We could definitely use for God to love the world. I agree with you there. And there's also another verse here. It says, Jesus said, I have loved you. Okay, he says, I have loved you even as the Father has loved me. So, wow, both those verses are really, really good, because we know what Jesus says is true. When he says he loves you, he loves you. So do not listen to that lie, Benji. Jesus loves you. Right, let's see what else. Oh, you are on your own. What verse could we use to say, no, that's not true, Benji? What could we say? What could we use? Could it be, oh, I'm the truth, the way, the truth, and the life? Maybe. But God is with us? Possibly.
David's got his hand up, Grace.
Oh, has he? I can't see. Sorry, David, you just unmute yourself, dear.
God is with us.
Ah, excellent. God is with us. It means he is with us. We, Emmanuel, that is a brilliant, brilliant verse to always remember. God is with us. So that's a lie. We're not going to listen to the devil. We are not on our own. God is with us. Let's have a look at the next one. Whoa, oh my goodness, you really were under attack there. You always do things that are wrong. How can we extinguish that lie? Because what can we use there? What truth? You know, sometimes when we believe that, we start to go, well, it's hopeless. I always try, but never works. What's the point of even trying to do the right thing? And so, because I'm always doing the wrong thing. So it can really get you down if you start believing that lie. So what can we use from the shield to say, no, that's a lie. I'm going to stand on the truth. Well, you know what? I can't see everyone. Oh, go on, David, again. I see you've
God is the way, the truth, and the life.
Well, yes, we can definitely use that. But what I would also say we could use, thank you, David, that's great. Yes, we can also see that, look, for God loved the world so much that he gave his one and only son so that everyone who believes in him will not perish but have eternal life. So when we do wrong and we sometimes get down and we feel hopeless and that there's just no way we can do the right thing again and it's just too much, we need to remember that we won't perish, we won't be brought down, we won't be overcome and separated from God if we believe in Jesus and we believe in him, because his word, he said that, so we can believe it. We will not perish if we believe in what he says and trust his word and follow him. All right, come on, let's see. You don't know which way to go. That can be, people be like, I don't know who I am. I don't know what to do. My goodness, it's just so too much. It's too confusing. I'm going to just do nothing. So hold on. What lie can we use against the devil and his lies there? We've got a truth. What's the truth we can hold on to? And we know absolutely this, that that's what the devil's trying to say is wrong. Well, I'm going to use, guess what? I think we've already used this one before, and it's a great one to use. And I love this one of this verse. I do love it a lot. But Jesus says in John chapter 14, verse 6, he says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Okay. And when we know that, we know who to follow, we know who to listen to, and we know who to trust and obey, because, and he is the one. Jesus is the truth. We don't need to be worrying about which way to go or what to do, because when we go to him, he will tell us, he will show us what to say, what to do, and how to walk. Well, that's amazing. So we've got this amazing shield from God, Benji. You know, this is what you can use this week. And as you listen and trust and follow God's word and listen to the words that come from Jesus and from God, you don't have to be overcome. You don't have to be sad, and you don't have to feel that no one loves you. You can know that what God says and what Jesus says is true, and you can stop those fiery arrows from getting to you and bringing you down. Wow. So, you know what, guys? This week, I'd like you to think, all you Lennox Church kids, of, yeah, it's been great they've been able to help Benji, but can you think about how you can use your shield of faith, love, and truth, and how you can use God as your shield? And thank you, God, absolutely thank you, God, for being our shield, because it's really important that, you know, we use our shields, because a shield helps us to protect us, and it blocks those things that projectiles, things that are going to try and break through, like our arrows, and bring us down. It also stops us from doubting God's word. You need to trust in the word of God and know his word is truth. And when we trust in God, we can use it as a shield, and this shield can help us stop the attack of the devil. And also another thing that's really cool is that we can help and protect others. Like, we were able to help Benji. We can help other people in our family, in our life around us, to say, you know what? We've got the truth. We know what the truth is, and we can follow Jesus. So maybe you can do that this week when you're going about all your activities. Okay, folks, we'll see you later. And thanks for being with us. We'll see you next time. Bye.
Well, good morning, everyone. I worked all my life as an accountant in the construction industry. I moved through the ranks from assistant accountant to group financial director in 4 years, and then remained in that job for over 30 years. And for my last 2 years, I was also the company chairman. When I was 48, however, I informed my colleagues that if I was still alive and had not been fired, I would be retiring early to do different things with my life. I did not know what they would be, but I knew it would be involved in Christian ministry. I was an elder in Carpsbridge Evangelical Church, but beyond that, I was staring at a blank page, looking for the Lord to guide. I actually retired at 59, and since then I have been a trustee at GLOW for 10 years, also lecturing for 2 weeks each year for 8 years at GLOW. I was a board member of Echoes of Service for 8 years and was the Honorary Treasurer of Scripture Union Scotland for a 5-year term. However, I felt that before I ran out of energy, I would like to be involved with a holistic dimension of Christian ministry. And I spoke to Dr. Ian Burness, who had been the General Director of Echoes of Service, the Brethren Mission Service Group, for about 25 years and who is one of the most knowledgeable people on global ministry in the world. And we brought together a team of 10 from all around the UK, with half of that team from Carpsbridge Evangelical Church. And so shared hope began. We completed 12 years at the end of 2020. And what I'd like to do firstly is go through the details of who we are and what we do. Firstly, what is our motivation? It is the second great commandment: you shall love your neighbour as yourself, by expressing mercy, by promoting justice, and by upholding dignity. What about our team? We're all volunteers. We all visit projects. We all contribute financially, and most of us pay all of our own travelling expenses. And in terms of finances, after 12 years, we have just topped an income of £4 million. And we give away every year what we get in. This is a faith ministry. We keep about 6 or 7 weeks' costs over into the next year. And by the grace of God, last year, with all its challenges, was the best year for finance that we have had. What about our strategy? Well, first, negatively, three things we don't do. We don't do buildings, we don't do vehicles, and we don't do good ideas. That means if you are in a village in Zambia and there are 100 kids that have no school and you say you have a vision to run a school, we would say that's a good idea, but we don't do good ideas. So if you start that school and if you prove yourself to be capable of organising and running that school, then we'll begin to think about the possibility of helping you. On the positive side, we only work with partners we know or with people we know and trust know. This is a high-risk business, and so we're very careful before we set up a link with our partners. We mainly partner with National Christians. Almost all our projects are run by nationals in the country where they are. And we link with two other charities who share our values. What about our impact? Well, we have 80 projects in 16 countries. And since we have started, we have been involved in 125 projects in 19 countries. And we reckon that we touch the lives of over 20,000 people day by day. And we support the following areas of holistic support: education, clean water provision, medical support, the social dimension like rehab, economic ministries, mostly through microloan, literacy and skills training, and support for the disabled. Now, what I would like to move on to quickly is not statistics, which are important, but stories. And I'd like to tell you three stories from the 80 projects that we have. And the first is a school in Kenya called Echoes of Mercy Christian School. Now, the first time I visited this school 10 years ago, there were 30 children in the school, and today there are 420 students. Now, you may be able to see if I have it here, an official report that comes out from the government for the area where Echoes of Mercy School is. There are 116 school reports in that government survey. And of the 116 schools, Echoes of Mercy School is rated number one. And the report is for the senior school level, where they sit five subjects. And the average mark last year, or the year before, I think that report was from Echoes of Mercy School, showed that the average mark for the kids in Echoes of Mercy School was over 10% higher than the second top school out of the 116 schools there. A couple of times when I've been there, I have given the senior class an essay to do. I give them 35 minutes and they do not know the subject in advance. And I don't know if you can see those, but it's the writing that is impressive. Every kid writes exactly the same way. You would think the same child had actually written every essay. "We teach our children how to write properly," said the head teacher to me. And I have to say to you, the quality of the writing is way ahead of anything that I have seen in this country. Now, the second project that I want to highlight is also linked with a Brethren Assembly, and it's in Madagascar, and it's a children's home, the Chadona Children's Home. But what makes it unique is that the 38 children in the home have amongst them 10 lots of twins. And that is because in the south of Madagascar, twins are deemed to be a curse and they are abandoned at birth. But the lady who runs this children's home has contacts in the south of Madagascar. And when Pauline hears that twins have been born, she rushes down to the south and rescues them. A couple of years ago, the government of Madagascar tried to ban this attitude, and such was the protests that the government had to back down. The third project I want to talk about is in Thailand, where stateless refugees from the surrounding countries like Myanmar and Laos live in 500 villages in the mountains. The Thai government does not want to know them. So they eke out a living by selling their kids into the sex industry in Bangkok and by growing poppies for the heroin trade. Mike Mann, the project leader, is a mission worker from the USA whose parents were Presbyterian missionaries in Thailand. Mike speaks Thai like a local. There are two dimensions to this project. Firstly, the provision of fresh water for the villagers from mountain streams. He has trained 25 of these hill people to become experts at channeling water by gravitational feed to villages an average of 6 to 8 kilometers away. And so far, 250 villages of the 500 villages now have fresh water directed into each home in the village. And instead of poppies, they now grow coffee. And this is linked to the provision of water, and it is done via a microloan scheme. And they now choose to grow coffee, and this is processed in New Zealand and sold into the market and shared hope, support the provision of water and a microloan scheme for the village for one village each year, and that is at a cost of about £11,000. Linked to the water and coffee production is evangelism. There are around 20 trained nationalist evangelists in the team, and over the last 25 years, 80,000 of these stateless people in the mountains have come to Christ from Buddhism. Some years ago, I visited this project with Ian Burness, and it was the most terrifying journey of my life. Torrential rain left the narrow mud roads almost impassable, and there was a drop of hundreds of feet with no barrier protection on the side of the road. As Mike, the mission worker, drove in there skidding constantly, he casually mentioned that the first time he visited that village he walked in, it took 2.5 days, and the second time he went by elephant. It was no place for motor cars, that is for sure, and I have never been more relieved to reach Chiang Mai, the city we set out from 2 days before. So that's just a brief run through Shared Hope, who we are, what we do, and who we help. But in the last 10 minutes before I close, I want to come back to the main subject of all of our lives at this time, and its name has been mentioned on two occasions, at least this morning, which is COVID, or the coronavirus. And I want to say something in that context from a prayer of Jehoshaphat, king of Judah. And it's a verse from 2 Chronicles chapter 20 and verse 12. And it says this: "We have no power to face this vast army that is attacking us. We do not know what to do, but our eyes are upon you." Now, we read in verse 1 of this chapter that the Moabites, the Ammonites, and some of the Meunites had come to make war on Jehoshaphat. Now, Jehoshaphat was one of the good kings of Judah. We read in 2 Chronicles chapter 17, the Lord was with Jehoshaphat. He made one big mistake in his reign. At one point, he joined with the wicked king Ahab of Israel. However, the king repented, and we read in chapter 19, verse 4, Jehoshaphat went out again among the people and turned them back to the Lord. In effect, he became an itinerant evangelist. So far, so good. But then, out of the blue, comes calamity, as suddenly and without warning, an enemy far more powerful than they were able to cope with came against them. And it seems to me that the 3 points Jehoshaphat makes in his two-sentence prayer have no little relevance for us today. To face this vast army that is attacking us. Firstly, then, Jehoshaphat prays this: "O God, we have no power." Now, I must confess, I have never felt so helpless in my life than I feel right now. If you had told me last February, as I flew out of Pakistan, having been there for 2 weeks and having had the privilege of speaking to 1,500 children as well as visiting 9 schools, a large further education training centre, a medical clinic, and a hospital, that 1 year later, I would not have left Scotland again and will not leave in the foreseeable future, I would have thought that you were winding me up. Yet, not only will we not be leaving the country, we are barely permitted to leave our homes. The great army ranged against us is an unstoppable force of nature. But then comes hope. Against the virus comes the vaccine, followed potentially by the return of fear as there emerges a variant. And of course, it does not only render us powerless, it renders us potentially lifeless. At 77 years of age, with 2 stents, I am what is called a vulnerable adult. In the context of life and death, no less. But wait a minute. In the context of the life of faith, we have never had any power. Here are the words of Jesus to his disciples recorded in John's Gospel, chapter 15. Apart from me, you can do nothing. You yourself have no power, says Jesus in as many words. And maybe this is a time for all God's people to learn that lesson. We are helpless, God, prays Jehoshaphat. We have no power. And what is more, says Jehoshaphat, we have no plans. We do not know what to do. For the first time in my life, I have no plans. Shared Hope is structurally a very efficient ministry with each team member totally committed to the work. But right now, we have no plans beyond supporting our partners in the field financially while we have that resource. We do not know when planes will fly. We do not know how expensive flying will be. We do not know whether or not some of us will be allowed to fly. We do not know if our donors will be able to continue the support, although in the goodness of God, so far, they have been remarkably generous. But this story has a happy ending, says King Jehoshaphat in his prayer. Firstly, we have no power. Secondly, we have no plans. But thirdly, he prays, we seek your provision, God. Our eyes are upon you. This is too hard for us, God, prays Jehoshaphat. So we are handing it over to you. And it's often at wit's end corner that the miracles happen. We read, then the Spirit of the Lord came upon Jahaziel. This is what the Lord says to you. Do not be afraid or discouraged because of this vast army, for the battle is not yours, but God's. Go out to face them tomorrow, for the Lord will be with you. Then we read these remarkable words. Jehoshaphat appointed men to sing to the Lord and to praise him. We are even given the title of the song they sang. Give thanks to the Lord, for his love endures forever. How incredible. The army became a male voice choir. Meanwhile, the enemy armies had fallen out with each other and destroyed each other. And we read in verse 24 of 2 Chronicles chapter 20, when the men of Judah looked toward the vast army, they saw only dead bodies lying on the ground. And the lesson here, my friends, is this. No matter how dire the situation, if God is for us, who could be against us? Amen.
Me what it meaneth, the rest which thou dost give to all the heavy laden who look to thee and live. Because I'm a rebel, thy pardon I receive. Because thou dost command me, I can and do believe.